We will begin with our opening processional hymn, Immortal, Invisible God, Only Wise. The words are in your worship folder. Welcome to St. Peter. For those of you I have yet to meet, my name is Pastor Micah. I'll be helping guide us through our service, our celebration of life for Jan Carter. And I just want to first of all thank you all for taking time to be present today for the service, as well as time with the family beforehand. If you did not get a chance to sign the guest book on the way in, the family would love to know that you are here and to thank you, so please make a note to sign that after the service. You'll hear also about an invitation to dinner, if you've not heard about that already, but I'll let Jim give that invitation. That will also follow after our gathering here today. Everything you need for our service and celebration of life today is in this folder that you should have received on the way in. If you do not have one or don't have one near you to share, there are plenty more in the basket towards the back. Feel free to go grab one at any point in time. So with that, we'll continue by calling upon God's name. In our grief, we call upon the triune God, who alone has conquered death and the grave. In the name of God the Father, who made us, and of God the Son, who died and rose victoriously to save us, and of God the Holy Spirit, who brings us to faith in Jesus and comforts us with his presence. Amen.
Thank you, everybody that's here. We really appreciate it. We're glad that you're here to celebrate the life of Janet Carter. And I can't go without saying all the people that helped us, my goodness, the meals, the bakery treats, the bottles of wine, the homemade soup, just wonderful. And it really helped us, really helped Jan, that we had that outpouring of love from so many of you. We are so appreciative of the people at St. Peter, and it wasn't just the love from St. Peter, it was also from the Orchard, it was also from the Fellowship Bible Church in Elgin. Thank you very, very much. We We so much appreciated your love and your service to us when we really needed it. One of the things that were very important was the rides to various appointments and various medical procedures, and the folks that got Janet to where she was supposed to be, that was a tremendous benefit to us and a tremendous service to us. Now, the other thing is that when I was on the board of directors of LCMS for 9 years, we met a lot of pastors and a lot of pastors' wives, and were very, very impressed by them. And I'm going to do a kind of a dangerous thing here. I'm going to thank some of those pastors, and I hope that I don't overlook somebody. But start with Pastor Micah and Sarah, and then Pastor Randy, and Pastor Tom, Pastor Chuck, Pastor Paul, who did the interment at Abraham Lincoln Cemetery. Thank you for those men and their wives that really served and ministered to Janet. And I can go on with Pastor Allen, Pastor Matthew, Pastor Michael, wonderful men with wonderful wives as partners in their ministry. Pastor Ty of the Fellowship Church in Elgin, and all the folks out there that supported us, prayed for us. We could feel your prayers. You told us that you were praying for us, and Jan really felt that. Now, Janet and I had a very blessed time together. We got married at a young age, and I would tell every young person here, there's nothing greater than being married when you're young. What a great time that was. And we traveled a lot. Janet followed me around while I was in the Marine Corps. We spent time in San Diego, and Janet flew to Hawaii twice to meet me for R&R. There's nothing like leaving a combat zone and meeting your wife in Hawaii. That was fantastic. We had a great time. And then when I was with the 6th Fleet in the Mediterranean, Janet flew to Munich the day before Oktoberfest started. And I got off the boat in Naples and took the train up to Munich. And then we were together, took the train to Innsbruck, Austria, and down to Rome, and finally back to Naples when I got back on board the ship, and Janet made her way home from there. But that was the start of it. And God has blessed us with wonderful friends, wonderful family, wonderful members of the body of Christ, and we just feel so blessed and so fortunate. Now let me tell you something about Janet's journey, and I'll start with 12 years ago when she was diagnosed with soft tissue sarcoma. And at the time, our doctor told us that he gave us the get your affairs in order, and you may have 6 months to do so. And from that time on, it was a valiant fight on the part of Janet and her doctors and her caregivers and the technicians and the specialists. She had that soft tissue sarcoma removed by surgery, and we were told that it might migrate to her lung, and it did. Fortunately, it was her right lung, which is a lot less complicated than her left lung. That had to be removed by surgery. And that was followed by colon cancer, which also had to be removed by surgery and with bouts of radiation. And then that was followed by liver cancer and finally bone cancer. But you know what, folks? We had a wonderful 12 years. It was punctuated by many great trips with family and friends and with fellow believers, and I can name a couple of them. We had a wonderful trip to Australia to see my teammates from track and cross country in college. That was followed up by a riotous, joyous trip to South Africa to celebrate the 25th anniversary of our sister congregation in South Africa. My goodness, the service only lasted 3.5 hours. I never saw so much shouting and jumping and singing and dancing. And our guys didn't dance that well, but it was a great service. And Jan and I turned to each other and we thought, boy, this must be like heaven is gonna be. Pastor Mandela, who was a friend of ours and who visited us many times, was a great servant of the Lord and a great comfort to our family, our whole family, not just Jan and I, but our children and our whole family. And the sainted Pastor Schmidt also did a lot to comfort us. So we had that blessing. We will forever be thankful for it. And we see a lot of people here that we're very thankful for because you really helped us when we needed help. Now, I would just like to close with prayer, and if you'll join me. Dear Lord, we so celebrate you and celebrate Janet, and we thank you for the gift of Janet's faith, for her strong faith that led Janet to accept and believe all of your fantastic, outrageous promises. And Lord, you gave her that faith, and you grew her in that faith. And we're so thankful that she trusted in you and trusted in your promises. And Lord, we'd close by saying and praying for the peace of Jerusalem, Lord. Please, if you will, Lord, the peace of Jerusalem. And we say all of this in the name above all names, the mention of which every knee should bend and each voice proclaim, Jesus is Lord. Amen.
Thank you. Amen. All right, thank you, Jim. What you'll notice about the next part of our service is it will be punctuated by scripture reading and some stories from family members and song. All three were dear to Jan. So next we'll sing the hymn, I'm But a Stranger Here.
I'm not afraid to die.
Next, we'll hear our first scripture reading from John chapter 14. I invite Jay Ford for that.
Good afternoon. From John chapter 14, verses 1 through 6. This is verses about a heavenly home and the way to get there. And as I think about that heavenly home and be back here at St. Peter, I have to say thank you to the church and to the school and to the youth group and to the singles group for all the help that they have given me over the years. It's been some time since I've been back. But they, throughout my young life, taught me many things about the faith, and at times rebuked me when I was weak and straying. And it was very important. I can't thank the church enough, and I'm eternally grateful. I am also eternally grateful, though, to the, as I think about that heavenly home, about my earthly home. And the home that was created by my father and my mother, who took it upon herself to make the home. She was a homemaker. And she did a lot of things with intention and on purpose. And it meant a lot to me. It was a refuge. It was a strength to be at home. She gave me a lot of love. Love that was patient and kind and did not rejoice with evil, but rejoiced with the truth. She didn't give up on people. She didn't give up on me. Rather, she hoped in all things and trusted in all things. And I rejoice with her in her heavenly home. I would want you to know, if I could speak for her today, that she wanted everyone to know about this heavenly home. She worked really hard on her children, but she would want you to know about it too. John chapter 14, verses 1 through 6. Jesus said, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may also be. And you know the way where I'm going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me." God's word.
Thank you, Jay. And to sing and celebrate the way to that heavenly home, our next hymn is Amazing Grace.
Amen.
Next, we'll hear from Elizabeth and 1 John chapter 3.
Thank you all for being here. It's really good to be in the family of God and to grow up in the family of God. And it's also really good to be in an earthly family and to grow up in a large, thriving, earthly family. And my parents have both been part of thriving, earthly families, and it's really good to see all of you here today. And also all of you from St. Peter's and from the other churches that have supported us along the way in trying to serve my mom well, serve my parents well. So, on the internet this week, I saw a video called "The Key to Bravery in Life is Brooding About Death." And it kind of seemed a little bit appropriate to where I've been the last 6 weeks since Mom passed away. It reminded me of two verses from Ecclesiastes that I've also had a lot of time to think about in the 12 years that Mom was sick and the many funerals that we've had in our families since that time. I guess you get to be a certain age and it becomes a more regular occurrence than you remember it being when you were younger. There are two verses in Ecclesiastes that say it's better to go to the house of mourning than a house of feasting, for this is the end of all mankind, and the living will take it to heart. The heart of the wise is in the house of mourning, but the heart of fools is in the house of pleasure. So, I guess you've all come to the right place today. The video proposed that the fear of death is the root of all anxiety. And in the book of Hebrews, which we're studying for our Bible study, thank you, Jesse, sitting over there. And doing the soundboard. Thank you. The book of Hebrews says that through death, Jesus might destroy the one who has the power of death, who is the devil, and deliver those who through fear of death were subject to slavery for their whole lives. And I wanted to tell you that my mom was not afraid of death, which we had a lot of time to talk about, especially in the recent months. She lived her life in the freedom of Christ. She longed to be like him, and that gave her tremendous confidence about his path for her and his plan for her. I was also deeply moved by a speech by John Piper that he gave under the title, "Can Joy Come from Sorrow? Lessons for an Authentic Christian Life." His lessons were, nothing can dislodge our joy in Jesus Christ, and that pain and joy are each grounded in different realities. The pain comes from our very real struggle with sin and death and the fallenness of ourselves and others in our world. But the joy is grounded in our experience of the Lord, his presence with us, and his people, and the hope of a sin-free heaven where we'll be united with him and our loved ones and those who have gone before. Piper wrote about the death of his own mother, and I wanted to read that to you today. He said, "I was 28 years old and married with a 2-year-old son. My mother and father were leading a tour in Israel, and I got one of those dreaded calls from my brother-in-law. He said, 'Johnny, your parents have been in a bus accident, and your mother is dead. We do not know if your father is going to make it. I will let you know.' I gave my wife the facts, and I went into the bedroom and knelt down and wept for a long time, as I had never wept before, with uncontrollable sobs. And as I wept, joy kept bursting out of the depths in the midst of my sorrow. And the things that Piper wrote about his mother are things that I could say about my mother, too. Thank you, Father, that she was a spectacularly good mother to me. Thank you, Father, that I had her for the years that I did. For myself, I had her for 50 years. Thank you, Father, that we cleared the air from teenage years of ingratitude. I think we've all been there. We've been through the teenage years. Thank you, Father, that she is happier now in the presence of Jesus than I am sad without her. And thank you, Father, that my father is alive and with us still. Remembering my mom has been a profound mingling of sadness and joy. The sadness is perhaps easy to appreciate in the loss of one's own mother. My childhood friend from St. Peter's wrote on her Facebook page a few years ago, "Nobody loves you like your mother." And when you lose a mother, that's a hard thing. So even as the sadness remains, I would like to spend the rest of the time talking about joy. And a lot of the joy in thinking about my mom is captured in the passage that I've been assigned to read, and I don't have a copy of up here. Thank you. I have my summary, but it's a mishmash of the translations from the different churches that I've attended. "By this we know love, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brothers. If anyone has the world's goods and sees his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does God's love abide in him? Little children, let us not love in word or talk, but in deed and in truth." My mom was a lover. Jay connected this passage with our mother. She was not one to use many words or speeches, although she did use those, and she would tell you that she loved you all the time. But she didn't merely write that she loved you or say that she loved you. She acted out her love for you all the time. And to illustrate this, I'd like to read from a longer obituary that I wrote about Mom. And I'm going to need some help because Mom loved the people in this room. She organized I don't know how many baby showers and wedding showers and celebrated life in our family by documenting birthdays and anniversaries for our whole extended family. She remembered each member annually on their special days, and she prayed for them as she mailed her cards to you. So if you ever received a card from my mom, a birthday card or an anniversary card, I want you to raise your hand so that people can see how many people my mom would regularly send cards to. Thank you. She met with other women from church to transform snapshots into creative memories, with Charlene Wright, that captured our family history. She painted ceramic trees and pumpkins and nativities. And as the family grew, she couldn't keep up with all the weddings, so she began to purchase nativity sets as gifts when people got married and started a new home. Who received one of these gifts from my mother? Okay, thank you. In her personal time, she loved mysteries, particularly the writing of Agatha Christie and the show Murder, she wrote. She also played board games, like the mystery game Clue, as well as card games. Please raise your hand if my mother ever read a mystery or discussed it with you, watched a mystery on TV or a movie that you went to, or if you ever played games with my mother. Thank you. Throughout the years, she developed an interest in genealogy, where she applied her talents to impose simple organization on what could easily become unwieldy data sets. It was her way of loving and honoring the family that had gone before. Now, this is not as big of a group, but who ever visited a cemetery with my mother or went through the records of an institution in order to document a genealogy? Yep. She rejoiced in the marriages of her children as our family expanded and welcomed her in-laws and their families into her life as blessings. And her grandchildren were added to our family and were precious to her. She reveled in the birth of each grandchild and embraced the children brought into our family through adoption. She was honored that Hannah Diamond Gale Carter bears her middle name, and she prayed for her grandchildren regularly and looked forward to large family gatherings and Grandparents' Day. Please raise your hand if actively, not merely with words, Mom welcomed you into her life and into her family. Throughout life's victories and challenges, my mom was resourceful and thoughtful. She loved not just with words, but actions at St. Peter as well. She not only volunteered her time for teachers and school activities and pageants and plays, but also led the Brownies and Girl Scout troops for both her daughters for over a decade. She planned campouts aboard submarines and aircraft carriers and tents and cabins and caves. 1 week, we even went to work on a horse ranch. In addition to creating badge projects for the entire troop and coordinating events from museum visits to securing tickets to the Bozo show, she moved each girl along in getting her badges. Are there any Brownies or Girl Scouts here today? And some of the moms that helped her to run those troops? It was a tremendous blessing in my life. And as many of you know, my asthma was a real problem when I was younger. But my mom planned all of these outdoor activities and took me along and researched where the nearest hospital was. And if we had to make a trip through the emergency room, well, we would do that. But in the meantime, we would pack all my medication and try to figure out what things would cause stress on my body so that I could do it with everyone else. She also loved to knit and sew and creating gifts for her family, donations for ministry and offerings for Ladies Guild and the Sewing Club. Who served with my mom in the Ladies Altar Guild and the Sewing Club? I know there's some of you out there. Come on, put your hands up higher than that, Mrs. Whitty. Thank you. Even after her children were grown, she encouraged the children of St. Peter in Arlington Heights by providing vacation Bible school refreshments and teaching Sunday school a few years. And then she decided she was going to retire from teaching Sunday school to create the craft bits for Sunday school classes. I think she did that for 15 years. I don't even know. I'm sure that those of you who worked with her on it know. But who worked with her on the Sunday school, making all of the craft bits, and serving the children of St. Peter? Are there any hands out there? I see a couple. Thank you for your work alongside her. Recognizing the image of God in all people, her sincere desire was to actively support the gift of life in others, beyond her family, into her community. She worked at PAD sheltering for the homeless with my dad for years. She donated to food pantries and packed Christmas gifts for children in countries far away and for children close to home who were impoverished, as well as gifts for children whose parents were incarcerated. She donated to schools, and she spent a lot of time picking out books to bring to the library at St. Peter's in South Africa for their trip. Please raise your hand if you worked with my mom in caring for the vulnerable through the ministries of St. Peter's or other organizations. She persevered through surgical resections and ablations and all the stuff that my dad went through. But even through that, she didn't merely serve in all of these things. She looked for ways to serve the people that she loved and the people that needed help. During these last months of bonus time, the doctor told her she was well enough to do whatever she wanted, but sick enough to consider that her time was short. So he asked her to think about what she might want to do. The next day, she told me that she had decided she would like to take a dream trip.
"Where would you like to go?" She said she wanted to go to the Ark Encounter
and the Creation Museum of Kentucky. When she was near death in 2012, we had gone to the Creation Museum when it was newly built, and my parents had taken several trips with their grandkids since then. So she invited Dad and as many of her children and grandchildren as could go, and we went to the Ark in Kentucky. She told me that she chose these museums because she wanted her descendants and loved ones to associate her with the message of these museums. She said, "I want them to know they were created in God's image for a relationship with Him, and that Jesus saves us from impending disaster." Even after a spring hospitalization, Mom was determined to continue to live life with her family. So we went to Door County for the 35th time for the family vacation, spread across Sister Bay to Gills Rock. And then, about 6 weeks before she died, we celebrated my dad's 80th birthday with a surprise party that my mom had helped plan. She wanted his birthday to be remembered, even though she was sick. And all of this is to say nothing of the labor of words and prayer for all of our family. In the last year of her life, she wasn't able to do as much actively loving to those near and far, and she needed a lot of help. So it was our turn to love and care for her, not merely with words, but in deeds and truth. And so we did. Everyone here today, whether you knew my mom well or simply knew one of her children who was caring for her, helped us through. Your presence here today is a comfort and a joy to us in the midst of sorrow. We couldn't have done it without you. Please raise your hand if you supported my siblings or I in caring for my parents. Thank you. Thank you very much. I want to share one more thing from a devotional that my mom and I have been reading. It's called Streams in the Desert. It was a devotional written by a missionary wife. It was published in 1925. It has wisdom from many different sources of the practice of Christianity. And part of the reason I like it is because it's not just one voice, but it's a compilation of voices from within the Christian church that were an encouragement to Mrs. Kalman during difficult times. It was written by a woman for women, but men can benefit from it as well. And many, maybe most of the sources are men of the faith. Mom and I would read it and discuss the day's devotional when she was in the hospital, and especially through her last year of life. We were also reading it during hospice to Mom, and we've been reading it since her death. My siblings have allowed me to inherit Mom's copy, and I purchased a bunch of them to give to Mom's friends and family to thank you for your love and support for her. I think that if she could encourage you during difficult times in your life that come after she's gone, that she would give you this book that was an encouragement to us. This is the devotional for November 18th. And I have a list of people that I'm trying to write dedications for the books, and I would like to put one in your hands so that you can have it from my mom. And I pass them out to her siblings and her dear friends today. And if you would like a copy of it, please let me know, and I will add you to my list if you are not on it already. The passage for today is Luke chapter 7. And when the men had come to him, they said, "John the Baptist has sent us to you, saying, 'Are you the one who is to come, or shall we look for another?' In that hour, Jesus healed many people of diseases and plagues and evil spirits, and on many who were blind, he had bestowed sight. And he said to them, 'Go and tell John what you have seen and heard. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, leopards are cleansed, and the deaf hear, and the dead are raised. The poor have the good news preached to them, and blessed is the one who is not offended by me.'" It is sometimes very difficult not to be offended in Jesus Christ. For the offense may be the result of my circumstances. I may find myself confined to a narrow area of service or isolated from others by sickness or by taking an unpopular stance when I had hoped for much wider opportunities and connections. Yet the Lord knows what is best for me, and my surroundings are indeed determined by him. Wherever he places me, he does so to strengthen my faith, to strengthen my power in his spirit, and to draw me into closer communion with himself. Even if I am confined to a dungeon, my soul can prosper in growth in him. The offense that causes me to turn from Christ may be emotional. I may be confused or troubled over many questions about life or my life that I cannot solve. When I gave myself to Christ, I had hoped that my skies would always be fair, but often they are overcast with clouds and rain. In these times, I must believe that when difficulties remain, it is that I may learn to trust him completely, to walk with him closely, to trust and not be afraid. It is through my mental and emotional struggles that I am being trained to reach out to others who are also being tossed by the storms. The offense causing me to turn from Jesus Christ may be spiritual. I had imagined that once within his fold, I would never again suffer from the stinging wounds of temptation. Yet it is best for me the way it is, for when I endure temptation and draw near to him, his grace is magnified in my weakness. My own character matures, and heaven seems sweeter at the end of the day. Once I arrive at my heavenly home, I will look back across the trials and turns of my path, and it is then that I will sing praises of joy to my guide. So whatever comes my way, I will welcome the Lord's will and refuse to be offended in my loving him. I'm glad that Mom today is having a great day, her best October ever of her favorite month, and that we can be confident that though we have sorrow for a time, that we will be with her again. Thank you for listening to me.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Next, we'll sing a favorite of the family, the hymn, "I Was There to Hear Your Mourning Cry." Next, we'll hear from Sarah and some readings from 1 Corinthians chapter 15.
Hi. So I'm Sarah Bartolome. I am one of Janet's daughters, and I'm the third born, which gives me the privilege and monumental and daunting task of following my elder siblings. So a lot has been covered about my mom and how awesome she was and the godly woman that she was and the awesome example that she was and her heart that was gentle and kind and patient. And so many admirable things can be said about my mom. My dad and my siblings did a really great job of detailing all of that. yes, and so it leaves me with less to say on that. And I'll just keep it simple to say that I'm so very proud of the race that she ran of faith, her faithfulness to the Lord, even in the very difficult times and trials. And I'm just really proud of just how she kept the faith and she finished the race. And I'm so grateful that I could see that example and that I could just walk with my mom in that time. But I think one of the most important things about my mom is the new life that began the very moment that she accepted Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior. And from that moment on, even as she aged, even as she became ill, even as she developed cancer, and her body started to waste away and break down, even as she aged and all those things, still yet her inner spirit was renewed day by day. And that was awesome to see and really encouraging to me. Then eventually her body, like the time had come for her to lay down the burdens and the cares and the pain of this world. And she did pass from this world into the from the land of the dying, that's us, into everlasting life that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. I'm going to read from 1 Corinthians 15, just a selection of the things. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins, in accordance with the Scripture, that he was buried and that he was raised on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. But each in his own order, Christ, the first fruits, then at his coming those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end when he delivers the kingdom to God the Father after destroying every rule and every authority and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet, and the last enemy to be destroyed is death. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. So I'm so grateful that Mom has that victory and that she has everlasting life. And today is a celebration because of that and because of Jesus.
Thank you, Sarah. Next, I'll invite Evangeline Ford for some special music.
Thank you.
Beautiful. And last but certainly not least, I'd invite David forward for our reading from Ecclesiastes.
All right. My name is David. I am the fourth child of Jim and Jayhip, and I will start by just diving into the reading. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 9 to 13. What gain has the worker from his toil? I have seen the business that God has given to the children of man to be busy with. He has made everything beautiful in its time. Also, he has put eternity into man's heart, yet so that he cannot find out what God has done from the beginning to the end. I perceived that there is nothing better for them than to be joyful and to do good as long as they live. Also, that everyone should eat and drink and take pleasure in all his toil. This is God's gift to man. This scripture brings to mind countless memories of Mom planting, watering, tending to, and picking vegetables in her garden in our backyard. She would spend what seemed like endless hours outside cultivating the plants while I used the swing set or sat on top of the monkey bars. The more I think about her love of gardening, the more I realize that gardening is but one example of how she found satisfaction in her toil. I can't remember her ever uttering a single complaint. Reserved by nature, she could sometimes be perceived as unemotional or difficult to connect with, but I actually think the opposite was true. She was deeply in control of her emotions and had an immense sense of calm and contentment in the Lord's timing that allowed her to remain composed and at peace throughout her life, during times of rest or times of toil. As I reflect on how Mom maintained such a stable sense of self, her response of gratefulness and stewardship to her blessings seems to be an important piece of her foundation. Mom was truly grateful for even the most mundane of resources. I'm immediately reminded of how she would dilute the hand soap in the dispensers with water to make it last longer. How we would always get our groceries in paper bags to then use them as our kitchen garbage bags in order to avoid purchasing the regular 13-gallon bags. Or the shoebox that she wrapped in birthday paper that she would reuse every year for our birthday presents. Famously called the birthday box, of course. Our daughter will not be blessed with the luxury of truly knowing her grandma, but I pray that we can instill in her the virtues of finding satisfaction in her toil, gratefulness, contentment, and being a good steward of her resources, just as Mom emulated those traits from Christ's example.
Thank you, David. Next, we'll sing the hymn, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God, and I just would note one thing. We chose the version especially for the fourth stanza and the use of the word wife. And so when we get to that point, I just want to make note of that. And since this is the anthem of the Lutheran Church, we invite you to stand as you are able as we sing all four verses.
Thank you.
Amen. You may be seated. At this point in the day, and after all that has been said and sung, you may wonder what more would a pastor have to say? And indeed, it is an honor to follow all that has been said. And the life and the legacy of our dear friend and sister in Christ, the triumphant Jan, for whom the kingdom is in full force and in full glory now more perhaps than ever before. And I'm also aware of the fact that I stand between you and a delightful meal at Maggiano's. And so I won't take long, but there are a few things I would like to share before we conclude today. And where I'd like to take you is to a similar occasion in the scriptures, in the Gospel of John and in the 11th chapter. And we're not going to cover every detail of this exchange, but it's the story of Jesus when he was faced with the death of a dear, dear friend. Someone, in fact, the scripture tells us directly that he loved. It's the story of Jesus and his friend Lazarus. If you'd like to follow along, you can pull out your Bible app or reach underneath you in a pew. There are NIV Bibles there. They're the black books. The brown ones or the maroon ones are our hymnals. We're going to just glance our way through it and take notice of what Jesus does when he comes face to face with death, and then what we can gain and learn from this story. So starting in John chapter 11, verse 1, "Now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha," just a short walk away, in fact, from the city of Jerusalem. We're told by John, this Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on their Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sisters sent word to Jesus, "Lord, note this, the one you love is sick." Now, there's all sorts of fantastic details that John includes just in those first few verses. And maybe as you heard me read them, your mind was going off and memories of these three individuals, Mary and Martha and Lazarus and Jesus. There is so much life they shared together. Lazarus was dear to Jesus, just like Mary, the one who anointed him, and Martha, the one who was so eager to serve, was loved by him. And you would think that when Jesus got word that one of his closest friends on the planet was sick, that Jesus, the great healer, would rush to his side to do what he certainly had power on earth to do. Perhaps that's what Mary and Martha thought. If we just call Jesus, he's the healer. He can take care of this sickness. Verse 4. "When he heard this, Jesus said, 'This sickness will not end in death. No, it's for God's glory, so that God's Son might be glorified through it.'" So whoever was listening when Jesus said that probably concluded, all right, Jesus is going to do what we've seen him do before. He's got the power to heal. He just got word that his best friend Lazarus is sick, and he's just said this won't end in death. So he's obviously going to head on up to Jerusalem and take care of things, or Bethany, just outside of Jerusalem. Now, verse 5, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. Twice in just a few short verses, John reminds us that Jesus loved these people. How in the world would he let someone who he loved stay sick? 12 years is a long time, right? From when we first heard that Janet was battling the first round of cancer. And man, she put up a fight. It was really remarkable. In fact, it was almost a year ago that I was called to come and pay last visits and anoint her with oil and pray over Jan, because we were pretty sure around about this time last year that she was going to be going home. She had fought the good fight, and the cancer was angry, and it seemed like her body was done. Would you know it? That little stinker kept on fighting. And we prayed for her and anointed with her oil for healing. And what do you know? Jesus granted her many more days, several more months, with which she could enjoy her family and those she loved and all the things that were dear to her, like you just heard. So God certainly has the power to heal. And his desire is that we would live long and fruitful lives, both here on earth, but even more importantly, we'd live for forever with him. God is a God of life, not sickness and death. So why in the world would Jesus let someone he loved stay sick? Verse 6. So when he heard Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was 2 more days. Doesn't that seem strange? He's just a short ways away. He could have rushed up to his friend's side and made him well, but he stalled for time. What a weird thing for Jesus to do. And after 2 days, long enough, as it turns out, for his friend to die, after 2 days, he said to them, "Let's go back to Jerusalem." Jesus, you see, is always in control. He knows exactly what is before him. He knows all that has come already, and he knows the plans that God has for good. And so for his dear friend Lazarus, the sickness that would not end in death did, in fact, cause him to die. And so when Jesus got up to the area around Jerusalem, as he was approaching the town of Bethany, they knew that he was on his way, but they wanted to let him know that he was, for some reason, too late. And so in verse 17, on his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now, Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Mary and Martha to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask." Martha, Martha. Such a dear friend of Jesus. You can imagine the mixture of emotions inside of her as she goes to meet her friend, the great healer. She wanted to let him know it's too late, he's already dead, but somehow or another she had this confidence that whatever Jesus was up to, he would get it worked out. God will give you whatever you ask. So this mixture of faith wrapped up with grief. Maybe you know a thing or two about that. Faith, hope in what is to come, but still wrapped up with grief. Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." And Martha answered, "I know that he'll rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Doesn't say in the text, but you may wonder, she was thinking to herself, "Rabbi, why do I need a lesson on the last day right now? Because my brother is dead. I know all that stuff, and it's good. I put my hope in it. But the fact is, right now, my brother is dead. And if you'd gotten here a few days sooner, that might not be the case." Grief wrapped up with faith and hope. What are we to do? Jesus answers her with these words, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die." Jesus declares that he himself has power over death and the grave. And then not even the stench of decay, which had already set in on Lazarus. Remember, when he goes to open the tomb, they say, "Lord, he's been in there 4 days. That means he's good as dead. And it already stinks." Maybe they could smell it on the outside. Right? Some of the unpleasantries of death. Right? But they were familiar with it. Jesus says, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. Elizabeth, you mentioned, your mom wasn't afraid of death, right? Isn't that a remarkable thing? To be struck with cancer, to go through so many procedures, to deal with chemo and radiation and all that stuff, and just to seem unflappable. It'd be nice to have an attitude and a posture like that, wouldn't it? How could Jan stare down her own mortality and not be terrified by it? Maybe you've asked yourself that question. Maybe you've thought about it for yourself. What will I do when I get sick? How will I feel and respond when facing my own mortality? For Jan, it was never in doubt, because she knew that this statement of Jesus was true. Though nothing else in the world may make sense, this she was confident of: Jesus, her resurrection and her life, already had secured her for life everlasting. And though her body may grow weary and old, she may get sick and even die physically, even so, Jan never feared death, because she knew that she already had eternal life. And in fact, right now, she is experiencing life even more fully than she ever had before, for she is with the resurrected Jesus. She is with the one who can stare down death and defeat it. She is with the one who has broken the power of sin and death over us and given us eternal life. Friends, I don't know where you stand in relation to all this. I don't know if you have followed Jesus for all of your life, from the time you were born and baptized into Christ, from the time that the Spirit of God took hold of you and granted you faith. I don't know if you have stayed true to God your entire life, or maybe you started there but wandered a bit, or maybe you're on the outside looking in. I don't know. But here's what I know is true. More than anything else, what Jan would want you to know is that the risen and the resurrected Jesus, the one who stared down death for Lazarus that day and invited him to come out living again, the one who has defeated death and brought Jan to eternal life, stands before you today too and says, I want you to be with me. I want you to experience life now and forever like you've never known before. And here's the thing. There's not a thing you can do or say to earn or deserve that gift. It just comes freely to all who would receive it by faith. Jesus, approaching Bethany and Jerusalem, goes to the grave of his friend. He asks, where have they laid him? Verse 34, come and see, Lord, they replied. And then verse 35, Jesus wept. Even though he knew his friend had to go through this sickness that led to his physical death, even though he was familiar with the pain and sorrow of losing a loved one, even as he stands there weeping, Jesus was not hopeless. He had not lost control. He said, it's time. It's time to break the power of death over my friend. And so he says, deeply moved, to those who were by the tomb, he says, take away the stone. But Lord, Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days. Verse 40. Then Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of those who are standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. And when he said this, he called out in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. And the dead man, the one who already stank, the dead man came forth, his hands and feet wrapped with linen cloth and a cloth around his face. And Jesus said to them, take off those grave clothes and let him go. Friends, there is a day coming where Jesus will stand on this earth and say to Jan and all those who have gone before us and have gone to rest in faith, It's time to come forth. Death has no power over you. I am bringing you life, even forevermore. Friends, that day, Jan will walk again. Jim, you'll have both legs. And you'll get to dance with her and with all those you know and love and all those who have gone before you in the faith, and you will enjoy life for forevermore. This is the gift that God gives to all who know Jesus, our resurrection and our life. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Jesus Christ until that resurrection life. Amen. We're near the end, friends, but we're not done yet. When Peace Like a River is our next hymn. Let's sing. I invite you to stand as you're able for time and prayer. Let us pray. Oh Lord, we thank you for all the blessings which, during her life in this world, you bestowed on Janet and through her on us. Especially we thank you that you made her your child and an heir of eternal life, redeeming her by Christ's sacrifice and sanctifying her by your Holy Spirit through word and sacrament. And we thank you that you have now brought her out of this life of labor and sorrow into the joy and peace of heavenly life with you, your saints, and angels. Grant that we may rightly know and acknowledge your goodness and mercy toward her and all your people. Hear us, O Lord. Grant to us who are still on our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith and not by sight, your Holy Spirit, that he may lead us in holiness and righteousness all our days. Hear us, O Lord. Grant to all who mourn a sure confidence in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may know the consolation of your love. Hear us, O Lord. Give courage and faith to the bereaved, that they may have strength to meet the days ahead and have the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love who have departed in the faith. Hear us, O Lord. Help us, we pray, in the midst of things we cannot understand, to believe in and find comfort in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Hear us, O Lord. God of all grace, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to bring life and immortality to light. We give you thanks that by his death he destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection open the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Strengthen us in the confidence that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, will be able to separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
We join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. One last reminder, after our service, you are invited, all of you, to join the family at Maggiano's in Schaumburg. If you need directions, there are maps out in the lobby. We can get them to you, paper copies, or you can look it up on Google. It will be in an upper room, I believe, and there's plenty for everyone who is here. Upper room to the left. I'm just getting the navigation directions. Thank you. So we'd love for you to join us. The doors open at 5 o'clock, which is as soon as it takes to get you there, and appetizers at 5:15. So please head straight there. If you've not signed the guest book out in the lobby, we'll move it off to the side so you don't block the way as we exit, but please sign that as well. With that, we'll close with our blessing and the closing hymn. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Let us go forth in peace, in the name of the Lord. Amen.